5, 4,
3, 2, 1,
0.
The moon. At this rate, we'll never go back. On February 22nd, a spacecraft the size of a phone booth named Odysseus made history by landing near the moon's south pole. Built by Houston-based Intuitive Machines, it became the first U.S. lander to touch down on the moon in over 50 years, and the first private lander to ever reach the lunar surface. However, the landing was far from flawless. Days later, it became apparent that during the touchdown, one of Odysseus's six legs had broken and the probe had tipped onto its side. Almost everything was still operational, but the real issue was the solar panels, no longer able to properly receive sunlight. This problem rang a death knell as Earth's controllers decided to permanently shut down the lander. A similar fate befell the Japanese spacecraft Smartlander for investigating the moon, SLIM, weeks earlier, which had successfully completed Japan's first lunar landing, only to end up overturned due to an engine malfunction during descent. The askew lander's solar cells were facing the wrong direction and failed to power its instruments and communications, leading engineers to terminate it as well. Just 10 days before SLIM's landing, an American private lunar lander named Peregrine experienced numerous anomalies post-launch, including a propellant leak that prevented the spacecraft from landing on the moon. Ultimately, the vehicle was redirected to disintegrate in Earth's atmosphere. Other lunar landing attempts by Japan and Russia in 2023 also ended in catastrophic incidents, this time on the moon itself. To date, only the space agencies of five countries have managed to land on the moon: the United States, the former Soviet Union, China, India, and Japan. And only one private company, Intuitive Machines, has succeeded, while several high-profile missions have failed due to technical issues leading to fatal miscalculations in speed, altitude, and orientation. A stark reminder that even half a century after the Apollo era, safely descending onto our satellite remains a challenging and perilous endeavor. Only China has recently achieved full success with the complex Chang'e 6 mission, capable of descending to the surface, collecting rock samples, launching, and then heading back to Earth. As for the automated probes, the more serious issue, however, involves NASA and private industries in a series of delays related to the Artemis project, which was supposed to return humans to the moon by this year. So what's happening? Has human ingenuity declined since the Apollo years? Can we no longer reach the moon after our forefathers did so six times with surprising ease? Okay, what do you say? Shall we delve deeper into the matter? This video will undoubtedly be useful in understanding the basis on which we are comparing the space endeavors of two completely different historical periods. The Artemis program initially aimed to return humans to lunar orbit in 2024 and to the surface of our natural satellite in 2025, an ambitious goal that, as we'll see, would have required a lot of money and luck to achieve. Due to a series of delays, it's now clear that these objectives will optimistically be met 3 years late. Considering the difficulties we're encountering in returning to our satellite, it might seem nearly impossible that over half a century ago, in less than 10 years starting from scratch and with only the aid of technology born from World War II, we managed to walk 12 astronauts on the moon. It feels like a regression in our engineering capabilities. But is it really so? Or is it just an impression? To explain this apparent difficulty in repeating feats already accomplished half a century ago, it will certainly be useful to address the issue based on five different arguments: money, politics, risks, different purposes, and technological diversity between the two eras. Money. It may seem trivial, but the first factor that prevented astronauts from returning to the moon for years is the lack of funds. The Apollo mission cost the United States the equivalent of $120 billion current dollars, Despite the funds allocated to NASA having increased in recent years from $21.5 billion in 2019 to $24 billion in 2022, Biden requested $26 for 2023, while a new moon landing program is estimated to cost almost $150 billion today. Not exactly peanuts. For a more precise idea, the U.S. federal budget allocated to NASA peaked in 1966, when it exceeded 4.4% of the total. In the last 40 years, it has remained below 1%, and in the last 15, it has even dropped to 0.4%. At its peak, NASA consumed about 5% of the entire federal budget, and more than half of it was allocated to the Apollo program. Taking inflation into account, the entire Apollo program would cost over $260 billion today. If you include the Gemini project and the robotic lunar program, necessary precursors to Apollo, the figure exceeds $280 billion. In comparison, today, NASA holds less than half of the total federal budget with a much broader range of priorities and directives. In the last 10 years, NASA has spent about $90 billion on the Artemis program. Naturally, with less money allocated to landing on the moon, it's likely that will make slower progress, even with technological advancements. Politics. However, money isn't the only obstacle to our return to the moon. Closely linked to financial realities are political realities. In the 60s, America was in the midst of the space race, a competition with the Soviet Union to achieve the most space firsts, particularly the landing of a man on the moon. The public was on board and energized by this idea, as were the legislators who directed NASA's ample budget. This type of expenditure, however, was profoundly unsustainable. As soon as America won, public interest quickly waned, and NASA's funding plummeted. There simply isn't the political or public will to spend that amount of money on a second moon launch. This combination of less political will and fewer financial resources forced NASA to make some crucial decisions between the late 1990s and early 2000s, decisions that still affect Artemis today. Namely, as the space shuttle program was winding down, NASA administrators didn't know what to do with the industrial capabilities and partnerships that had led to the shuttle. They decided to keep the infrastructure in place by reusing many parts of the shuttle, particularly the engines, and incorporating them into the Artemis project. Needless to say, such a compromise slowed down the entire design phase, forcing technicians to perform acrobatics to reconcile the past with the present. Moreover, to this day, each president of the United States has had a different goal, and with elections, the progress made previously in space was often erased. It happened with Bush, who saw the Constellation program, which would have returned man to the moon, canceled by his successor, Obama, who in turn approved the creation of the Space Launch System rocket. With Trump, the goal returned to the moon and Mars, and this time Biden has continued in the footsteps of his predecessor. These projects require many years, sometimes well beyond the two terms of a president, and for this reason, they often end up in nothing. Hey guys, just a moment before we continue. Be sure to join the Insane Curiosity channel. Click on the bell, you'll help us to make products of even higher quality. Risks. Another important factor to consider are the risks, or rather, the change that has occurred over the decades in the perception of risk. In the 60s, we took many risks, sometimes unknowingly, but much more often with full awareness. In this regard, it is said that Frank Borman, the recently deceased astronaut of Apollo 8, on the eve of the Apollo 11 launch, approached Michael Collins and said, "Dear Michael, do you realize that the rocket you are about to depart on, the most powerful and largest ever built, is made up of 5.6 million moving parts? Let's assume that each of them has a 1 in 1,000 chance of breaking or malfunctioning. Well, this means that overall you could find yourself with 5.6 million potentially lethal problems at liftoff tomorrow, not to mention the 3 million pieces that make up the command module and those of the LEM, the vehicle that should take you to the lunar surface and then launch to bring you home." It's not known what Collins replied to Borman, we can't imagine, but in any case, at that time, all this was considered acceptable, both by politics and public opinion. We can say we were lucky, But it's not true, as many think or remember, that everything went smoothly. The United States and the Soviet Union's initial attempts to fly a spacecraft to the moon were full of failures, including post-launch explosions, guidance systems malfunctions, and fatal errors with solar panel deployment. The Apollo project itself was plagued by setbacks and real tragedies. Consider the launch pad fire of Apollo 1, which killed three astronauts, or the gamble of Apollo 4's first flight, which was assembled on site with parts produced in different parts of the country and flown for the first time without prior testing. In that case, it was a success. Or the explosion of liquid oxygen tank on Apollo 13, not to mention Neil Armstrong's arrival on the moon, where he had to fly around craters and rocks to find a safe place to land, nearly running out of fuel. Although the Apollo program ultimately succeeded in landing humans on the moon, it was only the culmination of a journey that failed many times on its path to success. Today, we hardly remember those inconveniences, and memory for most of us makes everything that happened in that fabulous decade seem like a glorious ride without delays or obstacles. Also because at that time there wasn't the manic media attention for things going wrong as there is today. Back then, bad news was always presented with a pinch of patriotic optimism, if not completely hidden, and people tended to forget failures, considering them as inevitable and part of the learning process. Today, no government or space agency would dare set up a mission without having thoroughly tested the functioning of every single component of the rocket or spacecraft. Obviously, not everything can be predicted, but the current control protocol has in fact increased the duration of tests tenfold, and consequently also the funds available, so that nowadays NASA has to use much of its limited budget just to support risk control, with timelines that inevitably get longer and longer. Different purposes. When we talk about returning to the moon, we're actually talking about two very different realities. The Apollo project only had to land two astronauts on the moon for a few hours and then bring them back, a task accomplished excellently. But the first Artemis missions are designed around a completely different set of goals. First astronauts will spend up to a week on the lunar surface, which requires more food, water, fuel, and scientific instruments. Secondly, while for the Apollo missions the main goal was to beat the Soviets, the scientific investigation will instead be at the center of attention in the Artemis program, which means it involves a longer and more complex mission design. The Artemis program's intent is not just to bring humans back to the moon. It's about starting to build the infrastructure to maintain a permanent human presence there. Everything from supply depots in orbit to selecting sites for future colonies falls within the scope of the Artemis project. It's a much more demanding program because it provides the framework to realize the dreams of coming generations. And so it's normal that a much more complex target poses much more complex problems to overcome, especially with a much smaller economic budget. Technological diversity between the eras. Everything has changed since the Apollo program, including the now antiquated technology that brought humans to the moon in the 1960s. The engineers of the Apollo program had used the earliest computers of their time, including sensors that have since been made more powerful in a fraction of their original size. Much of the software and architecture customized for the Apollo program are in fact useless today for space missions. Moreover, that generation of technicians and engineers is now out of the industry, and much of that knowledge has been lost. We are learning how to do it again, but we are also learning with new and different technology. It's unrealistic to expect that NASA or one of its partners could simply pull out the designs of a 60s lunar lander and recreate it from scratch. Most of the technology used in those missions has long been retired, surpassed by the massive advances in computing power and material sciences made over the last half century. Every piece of hardware on a lunar lander must be sourced from modern supply chains, which bear little resemblance to those of the 20th century, or designed and produced anew. Additionally, every sensor and electronic component on the spacecraft must be created to withstand the harsh environment of outer space, a process the industry calls hardening. In short, what do you think? Doesn't it seem that there are enough arguments to be much more understanding of the delays that are holding back the return to the moon? Sure, we'll get there a few years late, but the important thing is to get there safely, with all the credentials to land and colonize. And not just to briefly visit as we did half a century ago.